Good morning and welcome to this online service of worship. This is the First United Methodist Church of St. Cloud, and my name is Pastor Kathy Thacker. And we are glad you're joining us today, wherever you are, your home, your work, wherever you find yourself. Thank you for being with us. We hope and pray that as you worship with us today, that you'll feel God's presence and you will know His love for you. We begin with Psalm 100. Make a joyful noise to the Lord, all the earth. Worship the Lord with gladness. Come into His presence with singing. Know that the Lord is God. It is He that made us, and we are His. We are His people and the sheep of His pasture. Enter His gates with thanksgiving and His courts with praise. Give thanks to Him. Bless His name. For the Lord is good, His steadfast love endures forever, and His faithfulness to all generations. This morning, our opening hymn is Victory in Jesus.
Savior forever.
Thank you, choir. We invite you to go to God with us in prayer this morning. At the close of the prayer, we will say together the Lord's Prayer. Let us pray. Gracious and loving God, we give you thanks for this day and for your presence with us during this time of uncertainty and pandemic and unrest in our world and in our country. We thank you, Lord, for the many blessings that you give us, that you are our anchor in the midst of the storm. May we focus on you and you alone, not on the uncertainties, not on the concerns of this world. We thank you, Lord, for sending your Son, Jesus Christ, to earth to be our Lord and Savior and to be our High Priest. We are so grateful that he is fully God and fully human and able to understand us in our weaknesses. We pray today for those in need of your healing touch, especially for those who are suffering with the coronavirus. We thank you for the first responders and healthcare workers who are taking care of them. Give them strength. We pray for wisdom for those who are developing a vaccine and coming up with new ways to treat this virus. We pray for our country, for us to be one, to remember that there's beauty in diversity and that we learn from each other. And so, Lord, be in our midst that we would treat people with respect and dignity. And go before us, Lord, giving us wisdom and guidance in everything that we do, in our relationships at home, in our relationships and in our work, and with all those that we come in contact with, that we might be Christ's hands and feet. We ask all of this in the powerful and precious name of Jesus, as together we pray the prayer Jesus taught his disciples to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Our scripture today comes from the book of Hebrews, chapter 4, verses 14 through 16. Jesus, the great high priest. Since then, we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God. Let us hold fast to our confession. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but we have one who in every respect has been tested as we are, yet without sin. Let us therefore approach the throne of grace with boldness, so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help in time of need. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. We're continuing our sermon series on unshakable hope. And if you remember from last Sunday, we looked at God's promise that God gives grace to the humble. Today, our promise is that Jesus is our great high priest, and he's able to understand us in our weaknesses. It's important to be understood. One of our needs is to understand and to be understood. There's a story about a little boy who goes into a pet shop to purchase a puppy. So he asked the owner of the pet shop to show him the puppies, and he goes to this little area, and there's about four puppies, all different colors, playing together, rolling around, licking one another. They lick his hand. They're having so much fun. And he's laughing and playing with them. And then he says to the owner, "Do you have any more puppies?" And the owner says, "Well, I do have one other puppy, but he is crippled, you see. His leg is hurt." And the little boy's eyes lit up, and he said, "I would like to see that puppy." And so the owner goes and gets him and brings him out, and sure enough, there's this wonderful bond between them. The little puppy is licking his face and making him giggle, and he says, "Oh yes, this is the one I want. This is the puppy I want." And the owner looks kind of puzzled, and he says, "Are you sure that you want this puppy?" And the little boy says, "Yes, I am sure." He pulls up his pants leg to reveal that he is wearing a brace. You see, he too is crippled. And he says, "I understand this puppy, and this puppy understands me." You see, this is why Jesus came to earth, so that he could show us that God can be understanding and live in a human form, but also reveal to us God's divinity and love. The scriptures tell us that we have a great high priest, Jesus, who is able to understand us in our weaknesses because he came to earth as a human being. As a pastor, I talk with a lot of people who go through difficult times. And maybe you have been through something lately. Maybe you've lost your spouse after 50 years of marriage. Or maybe you no longer have a job because of this coronavirus pandemic. Or maybe you have worries and concerns about one of your family members who is dealing with a terminal illness. Jesus understands what you're going through, and he brings mercy and grace just when you need it the most. And oftentimes we will find that the most difficult times in our lives are the times when we feel God's presence with us the most. This week on the radio, I heard the announcer say it's a strange time to be doing something new, to be starting a new job, going to a new church, or being in transition in a new ministry or a new school. We all need understanding during transitions. I was born in Cheverly, Maryland. I am the oldest of four siblings. There's two girls and two boys. We're all 2 years apart. And when I was 8 years old, the family packed up and we moved to Kissimmee, Florida. And I've lived there the rest of my life. I remember the trip to Florida. We were in South Carolina and we started looking around and we said to our dad, "What is that in the trees?" And he said, "That's Spanish moss." And we said, "We have never seen that before." Then we stopped for breakfast and we ordered eggs and sausage and bacon and toast. And when the breakfast came, there was this white sticky substance on the plate. And so we asked Mom, "What is this that's on the plate with our eggs and bacon and sausage?" And she said, "That's called grits." And we said, "We've never seen this before." You know, there are times when we go through something that we have never seen before, we haven't experienced, and this is when we need God's mercy and grace the most. And when you find that you're in a place like that, you know that you need greater understanding. And God created us in His image and knew that we would need guidance and wisdom. And so God sent His one and only Son, Jesus, to earth to take on human form, to show us and teach us about His love, and ultimately to be our Lord and Savior. So the first point this morning is the Word became flesh. In John's Gospel, chapter 1, we read this: "And the Word became flesh and lived among us, and we have seen His glory, the glory as of a Father's only Son, full of grace and truth." You know, just like the little boy who wanted the puppy, just like him, God desired for us to know Him as a human being, to communicate with us, to relate with us. So Jesus emptied Himself of His glory and came to earth. He was subject to all the limitations of a normal human being. He was limited by human nature. He needed nourishment. He would get hungry and need to eat. He would get tired and need to rest and sleep for strength. He understands what it's like to have joy in an occasion, to be with people and friends and family and laugh. He also understood pain and suffering. He lived in a family. You can imagine there was a lot of fun in Jesus' family. He had brothers and sisters. They probably enjoyed playing together while growing up. And you can imagine that they tested their mother's patience every now and then, on an occasion or two. We know, in fact, that He got in trouble when He was in the temple in Jerusalem, when the family went to Jerusalem for Passover. We read about this story in Luke chapter 2, verses 41 through 52. The family was there for Passover. Every year they went. And so when Passover was over, the family returned, started the trip, the journey home to Nazareth, about 60 miles away, to home. After one day's journey, they discovered that Jesus wasn't with them. He wasn't with the family. After 3 days, they went back to Jerusalem, and after 3 days, they found Him in the temple, surrounded by the teachers, asking questions, and they were amazed at His understanding and His knowledge. But Mary, the mother of Jesus, says to Him, "Child, why have you treated us like this? Look, your father and I have been searching for you in great anxiety." We then read that Jesus returned to Nazareth and was obedient to them. He increased in wisdom and in years and in divine and human favor. We also know that Jesus suffered terribly at the treatment from the Roman soldiers. He was flogged, he was beaten, and eventually he hung on the cross, was crucified, and died. And so whenever we have pain and suffering, we can remember that whatever we're going through, we have not endured the pain and suffering that Jesus endured for us. He suffered and died for us. He was both fully divine and fully human. So that's the second point today. He was fully divine. In Colossians 1, 15 through 16, we read this: "The Son is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn over all creation. For in Him all things were created, things in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or powers or rulers or authorities, all things have been created through him and for him. The fullness of God, every bit of him, took residence in the body of Christ. He may have looked human, but those nearest to him knew that he was prone to divine exclamations, in other words, miracles. Every so often, Jesus would reveal something and people would see his divinity take over. And they would say, "What kind of man is this? Even the winds and the waves obey him." Those are those stories where there's exclamation points at the end. And that storm and the story of him calming the storm and the seas is found in Matthew 8:7. Max Lucado tells the story of serving as a teacher on a week-long Bible retreat. He said it was a wonderful retreat from many, many perspectives. But the highlight was a basketball game on Friday night. And the reason that that was the highlight was because there was an NBA star, David Robinson, who was an all-star, MVP, most valuable player, three-time Olympian, who showed up to play at the basketball game that night. And of course, all of the rest of these men were pudgy, middle-aged, well-meaning, and out of shape. The night of the game, David walked onto the court for the first time all week, and all the others had been practicing and dribbling and passing and getting their game to the best that it could be. He said his ball fit in his hand like a tennis ball. He carried on conversations while he dribbled down the court. When he threw the ball, it was like a missile. Eventually in the game, he let loose, and Max said with three strides, he roared from half court to the rim, slammed the basketball with the force that left the backboard shaking. And then he goes on to say that he can imagine that that's what it would be like to have been around Jesus when he was alive and to see the miracles that he performed. You know, that is how the game was meant to be played. And the followers of Jesus probably thought the same thing when they saw the way that Jesus lived life and when he stilled the storms and the winds, when he raised Lazarus from the dead, when he took the loaves and the fishes and he fed thousands, when he turned the water into wine at the wedding of Cana. No one argued with Jesus when he said, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me." That's Matthew 28:18. So this leads to the last point this morning. God gets you. In Hebrews 4:16, we read, "Let us therefore approach the throne of grace with boldness, so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help in time of need." If you ever wonder if God understands you, he does. If you ever wonder if God listens, he does. If you ever wonder if the creator of the world can comprehend the challenges that you face, then think about this, that you can approach the throne of grace with boldness. Jesus is able to understand our weaknesses, and the one who hears your prayers understands your pain. Are you anxious? Do you remember the prayer that Jesus prayed in the Garden of Gethsemane? He said, "My Father, if it is possible, let this cup pass away from me, yet not what I want, but what you want." He gets you. He understands you. He was so human, he could touch people, and so mighty that he could heal them. He was so human he could blend in unnoticed for 30 years, but so mighty that he could have impact for 2,000 years later. 3 years ago, I had the privilege of going to the Holy Lands and walking the places where Jesus walked. We went to the Jordan River, where Jesus was baptized. And I put on a white robe and I went down under the water, held my nose and remembered my baptism. And I remembered Jesus and what he did for me and for all of us. Afterwards, I can't describe to you how I felt. It was like I was washed, like I was clean and light and no burdens at all in my heart. You know, Jesus came so far, all the way to earth, to reach us. And we can take our weaknesses and our fears and our anxieties to him because he is our great high priest and he is able to understand all that we go through. Won't you do that today? Let us pray. Gracious and loving God, thank you for sending Jesus, your Son, to earth to be our Lord and Savior. He was fully divine and fully human and knew all of the pain and suffering that we have experienced and intercedes for us on our behalf and understands all that we're going through. Help us, Lord, to take our concerns and our anxieties to him and give them to him each and every day. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Today, we invite you to give to your church through tithes and offerings. There are three ways that you can give today. The first is online on the website homepage. There is a button that says Giving Online. You may click on that button to give to the church securely. The second way is to write a check and mail that check to First United Methodist Church of St. Cloud at 1000 Ohio Avenue, St. Cloud, Florida, 34769. And the third way to give is to set up in your checking account automatic pay to have a check sent on a regular basis to the church. And we thank you for your faithfulness to the church over the years. We continue to have our prayer groups and Bible studies and leadership meetings, as well as continuing to make improvements to our properties. The preschool will start again in August, and we are talking about the reopening of our Mercy Ministries, which will be opening in the future. So please stay tuned for more information. Let's pray. Almighty God, we thank you for the blessings of family and friends. We thank you for all good gifts that come from you. We ask that you would bless the gifts of tithes and offerings that we receive this week, that they would be used for the building up of your kingdom, that they would be used to bless others around the world, and particularly in this community of St. Cloud. We ask all of this in Jesus' precious name. Amen. This morning we have a special music piece, In Christ Alone, sung by Scott Wyrick, who is a teacher at Den John Middle School and lives in Kissimmee. Thank you.
Christ alone will I glory, though I could pride myself in battles won. For I've been blessed beyond measure, and by His grace alone I overcome. Oh, I could stop and count successes like diamonds in my hand, but those trophies could not equal to the grace by which I stand. In Christ alone I place my true rest and find my
closing hymn is I'm So Glad Jesus Lifted Me.
Lifted me, singing glory.
Now receive the benediction. Go forth today knowing that God gets you. And may God the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit go with you now and forever. Amen. God bless you. We'll see you next Sunday.